Thank you very much, Madeleine, for the introduction. Firstly, before I start, I want to thank everyone who made this happen. We have heard in the opening speeches that it was actually planned to have as an encounter, as an event in Marbach, but due to the pandemic, we had to renegotiate, to think of other concepts, and I'm very grateful that we can do that tonight here from Namibia, from Germany, from all over the world together. So therefore, a thank you to everyone who made this happen. Then let me move on and officially say good evening and a very warm welcome to everyone everywhere and to this very first panel of the virtual event series Narrating Africa Step 2. I am very delighted about presenting a panel on diversity and Namibian literature, or more precisely, actually, literature from and about Namibia, or Namibia in literature. Diversity, our today's topic, is a very crucial and a very central concept in today's society, acknowledging differences and at the same time offering more equality, or even similarity, as some of the critics say. Diversity is also a very prominent topic in literature, as literature mirrors or even foreshadows trends in society. Today, we present and discuss literary texts from three different authors, namely Penda Diop, a Franco-Senegalese dramatist who traveled Namibia and wrote about Namibia. Sylvia Schlettwein, a Namibian-born and German-speaking writer and translator. And last but not least, Remin Gamisha, a Rwandan-born writer and photographer who lives in Namibia. Not only the background of these three authors already represent the diversity, I'd say, but also their texts present different literary genres. We are going to have a play, or more precisely, a monodrama, a novel, and a short story. Furthermore, diversity is a topic in their works and asks, in my opinion, for a closer look and a discussion we will have this evening. Just as a very short information on the agenda, after a quick introduction of our panelists, all three will read excerpts from their works in English and, as we heard, in French, where you will have subtitles. After the reading, we will engage in a discussion, and also the audience is invited to send questions in the chat or to send them directly towards at the end of the session. My name is Julia Augard. I lecture at the University of Namibia in the Department of Language and Literature Studies. And together with my colleague Nelson Mlambo, we will host and moderate this session. And I'm really looking forward to this evening with all of you here. And Nelson, I think it's over to you.
Thank you very much, Julia. My name is Nelson Mlambo. I am a senior lecturer in the Department of Language and Literature Studies at the University of Namibia. And I really, really enjoy teaching different modules, especially African literature as well as Namibian literature in English since independence. And I will ask Penda Diop to also introduce yourself.
Hello, everybody. I would like to thank you for this invitation. I'm very happy to participate today at this roundtable. So my name is Penda Diop, and I'm a playwright, and I'm writing libretto in operas too.
Thank you so much, Penda. And next is Sylvia Schlettwein. Please, Sylvia, you can introduce yourself to the audience.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Sylvia Schlettwein. I was born on the 16th of November, 1975, which makes me exactly 45 years old. So I'm slightly older than independent Namibia. And I I originally wanted to become an actress, and I thank the University of Cape Town's drama department very much for rejecting me, because it made me find out that I'm actually a writer. And I became a teacher, which is also a bit like being an actor. I was not only born in Namibia, I grew up there, I went to school there, and then I went to study in Stuttgart, of all places. So hi to everybody in Marbach and Stuttgart. I know you guys. And Stuttgart was actually the place that taught me that tribalism doesn't only exist in Africa, because it was in the southwest of Germany where, yeah, the Schwaben and the Badenser talked about each other as, yeah, some tribes here back at home do. And I studied German and French language and literature. My mother tongue is and will always be German, but I write in English and German. And my writing itself is diverse already. I write short stories, poetry, and I like to experiment with genres as well. I do creative nonfiction, speculative fiction, and because Corona has blocked me so completely, I have to venture into the autobiographical at the moment to be able to write other stuff again. And thank you very much for having me here today, and I hope we can talk about some of the topics that are also topics of my writing, like identity, language, and pain and love and sharing and diversity.
Thank you so much, Sylvia. Quite a rich heritage indeed. Over to you, Remy.
Remy. Hello, everybody. Yes, hello, everybody. My name is Remy. I was born in Rwanda, moved to Namibia in 1996. I've been living here since. So for all intents and purposes, this is home. I did my primary schooling here, my high school over here, before I moved abroad to live in South Africa for a couple of years while I was attending university, and then I moved back in 2013. I have always had a passion for the arts, but not necessarily always had the means to participate in the arts. But I have found my niche within the arts, and it is con artistry. I've convinced everyone I am a writer, so I'm going to stick to that because I've been told it's too late to pull back. I think I've come too far now to actually rouse people from the dream. But that's my passion. I enjoy writing, I enjoy photography, and my ambition really is to find ways and means to bring more Namibian literature, not only to my countrymen, but also to the rest of the continent and the world. And that's me in a nutshell.
Thank you very much, all three of you. I think now we have an idea where you, who you are, and but we want to know who you are as a writer. So we want to listen to you. We want to listen to your narrations. And maybe, Sylvia, can we start with you? And you decided, or you told us that you will read from a story from your publication, Please. And it is Mother of the Beast. Am I correct? The floor is yours.
Thank you. Mother of the Beast. His first word was not mama. It was not papa either. It was you. You, talk to me. He was one of those who only started speaking once they were well prepared. He knew how to speak before he spoke for the first time. No trial and error, no learning by doing. The woman who he assumed to be his mother, the farmer's wife, Ingeborg Jansen, was only mildly surprised when he suddenly addressed her in the correctly constructed imperative from where he was lying in his basket on the kitchen table. She had always felt, or maybe even known, that something was different about her little Waldemar. Even though he was neither her own flesh and blood, nor her own kind, She felt she understood him like nobody else could. So she answered him. We found you orphaned in the bush one morning while patrolling the farm fences, a black-backed jackal puppy lying on the red soil next to the fence. You didn't whine, you didn't growl. There was absolutely nothing wrong with you. The only strange thing was your tail tip, which is red, not black. You lay there abandoned and alone, and I felt this uncontrollable urge to cradle you in my arms. You were such an adorable, furry little creature. And Hubert, who usually shoots every jackal inside, just looked on. I think he was hoping that you would help me get over being childless. When we found you that morning, we had already been trying to conceive for 4 years, unsuccessfully, as you can imagine. Not even a miscarriage to weep about. I called you Waldemar and reared you on milk, eggs, and minced meat. When Waldemar was 5 years old, he decided to leave the farm and become a city jackal. Ingeborg cried when he jumped onto the passenger seat of Hubert's Hilux buggy. He wiggled his ears, wagged his bushy tail and said, "So long, mother. Don't wish me luck and don't cry. I'm a wild animal after all. You shouldn't get too attached." "But I'm already attached," Ingeborg spoke through her tears. "Wild animals don't belong in the city." "Oh, for goodness sake. Windhoek is not exactly Paris or New York," Hubert interrupted impatiently. "I leave him with Uwe and his family first, and then when he's ready, he can leave and make his own way. If he wants to, he can even go and live in one of the dry riverbeds. City police won't chase him away because he's not a human vagrant and he can meet some of his own kind there. Maybe even a nice jackal lady or two." Hubert made a snorting noise, started the buggy, and they disappeared into the morning light, leaving behind a frantically waving Ingeborg, fluttering white handkerchief in hand. Hubert and Waldemar did not speak a word on their way to Windhoek. Not that it surprised Waldemar, because Hubert only very rarely spoke to him. Maybe out of disdain, maybe because of his fear of being verbally outdone by a beast, the likes of which he was used to controlling with his rifle and jackal-proof fences. Maybe because he generally limited his use of the spoken word to no more than was absolutely necessary. Waldemar didn't care, as long as Hubert would get him to Windhoek in one piece and not secretly execute him on the way there, out of jealousy for Ingeborg's attention, or for want of a hunter's trophy, or both. The decorative jackal fur mat in the farmhouse lounge had to have come from somewhere. Waldemar knew that in his house, Hubert only displayed trophies of animals that had fallen by his own hand. For Waldemar, entering Windhoek meant the appearance of the big blue square building with the individual little yellow, green, white, and red mosaic blocks and two slender gray chimneys. Van Eck Power Station looked a bit like a child's building block construction, and it had been the first building Waldemar noticed when the Janssens had taken him to the capital for the first time. He half hoped Hubert would throw him out there. The toy-like appearance of Van Eck and the high grass of the surroundings made him feel safe and welcome, but no such luck. Hubert drove on into the city center and then into Klein Windhoek, where the streets were named after German pioneers and Namibian rivers, and white houses with red roofs stood within lush gardens, guarded by Dachshunds, Alsatians, and Dobermans. They turned into Metzjestrasse and stopped in front of a big black gate, which opened after Hubert rang a bell and spoke into an intercom. "Are you leaving me here?" asked Waldemar. "Yes." Waldemar stole one more look at the gate and the matching iron bar fence, then he leapt over Hubert's lap and out of the open window onto the street and fled into the riverbed behind the bus station across the street. You remembered Hubert's talk of dry riverbeds and vagrants and his own kind, when he came across two down and outs sipping from a bottle of methylated spirits. Hello, I'm Waldemar. I'm looking for other jackals. Have you seen any around here? He thought they would never stop laughing. Aye, tell the German jackal I can't understand him, one said, slapping his thighs. Master jackals, please, Baas, his companion addressed Waldemar. My friend here says you must repeat everything in Afrikaans because... The rest of the sentence was lost in high-spirited laughter, which was all the same to Waldemar, whose contact with Afrikaans had been limited to the pieces of conversation that reached him when Hubert or the boy spoke to the farm laborers at the kitchen door. Ich liebe dich, the first vagrant shrieked, the only sentence he knew in German, and took a swig out of the bottle with the purple liquid. I love you, Waldemar mused, whether the drunkard had directed the declaration at his drinking mate or at him. Eins, zwei, drei, the other vagrant added his collected knowledge of German numbers before Waldemar could find out whom the first one had claimed to love. They laughed hysterically when their faces were sprayed with spirits as they spurted with amusement. Waldemar was not going to be pointed in any direction by two intoxicated fellows who didn't understand his language, and so he wandered further down the riverbed. It was getting dark. He was lost, hungry, and tired, and eventually crept under a gray bush with an unfamiliar scent, where he fell asleep. He was woken by the howling of his own kind, a sound he recognized from nights on the farm, and he found himself howling back instinctively. His jackal voice reverberated through his body, but he did not understand a single of his own howls, let alone what the others were howling back. They were coming closer, and he eagerly awaited and feared the red faces and black backs of his animal kin.
Danke, thank you very much, Sylvia, for that reading. We will go into discussions after we've heard all three of you. I think then we can interact a bit more. I think we still go for ladies first and a French text in between. Penda, I can't show the book. I only have it on my computer, but wonderful. Yes, you have it. So we are working quite well together. Thank you. And I'm excited to listen to your text in the French original. Thank you. And for everyone else, don't forget to click on your subtitles if you want to read the English translation along.
Prologue. Te souviens-tu des dunes? Te souviens-tu des dunes de Namibie? Te souviens-tu des dunes de Namibie et du roulis du sable sur leurs flancs, de la mélodie de leurs flancs, de l'aine des dunes de Namibie, d'où s'écoulent des grains de sable, égrenés un à un, roulant sur eux-mêmes, précipités dans la chute de reins vertigineuse de la dune, ils brûlent d'impatience de rouler sur le sol, loin de leur point d'origine, un endroit d'où ils ne verraient plus, d'où ils ne verraient rien, car leurs yeux ont tout vu, et leur rétine a brûlé. Ils chantent leurs complaintes dans un ruissellement tantôt féerique, tantôt maléfique, d'une mugissante. C'est la complainte du grain de sable rôti au soleil dans le désert du Namib qui roule, qui tombe, qui chute. Ce sont les pleurs sans larmes des grains de sable, témoins des morts millénaires, témoins des corps décharnés, de la soif, de l'oubli des autres continents. Ce sont pour les corps pris au piège allemand que les grains de sable, égrenés par le vent, hurlent leur douleur. C'est le blues de Big Mama, dont les côtes pleurent ses enfants morts. Le désert du Namib, malgré la signification de son nom, bouclier, n'a pas suffisamment protégé. Pour la première fois, ordre est donné de n'épargner personne, hommes, femmes et enfants. À l'intérieur des frontières allemandes, Chaque herrero, avec ou sans fusil, avec ou sans bétail, sera fusillé. Je n'accepterai plus ni les femmes, ni les enfants. Je les refoulerai vers leur peuple ou ferai tirer sur eux. Telle est la parole que j'adresse au peuple herrero. Le grand général du puissant Kaiser, von Trotha. Sous ce soleil radieux, dans ce paysage lunaire, désertique, tellement beau que les larmes me viennent, des hommes sont morts. Des hommes sont morts. Seul le minéral se souvient. Le grain de sable qui cherche à fuir sa réalité, ses yeux, ses sens. Il se souvient et se sauve. Il chante. Et quand tu viens, touriste, des vallées crazy dunes, batifolées sur les flancs rouges de Big Mama, surfer sur sa croupe rebondie, n'oublie pas le chant du grain de sable. N'oublie pas ce cri muet de l'abandon, de la tristesse et de l'oubli. Ce chant du siècle dernier qui résonne encore aujourd'hui. Lausanne, Oslo, Atlanta, Tokyo, Zurich, Stuttgart, Athènes. Je ne sais pas toujours bien situer ces villes dans le monde, mais je suis chaque été, avec passion, les grands meetings, les championnats du monde et les Jeux olympiques d'athlétisme. Quel que soit l'horaire, impossible de ne pas suivre le 100 et le 200 mètres. Parce que ce sont les disciplines reines, dominées par des Afro-Américains sur deux, musclés, gainés, moulés dans leur juste au corps saillant. Il en faut peu pour la gamine de 15 ans. Et puis, il y a Frankie Fredericks. Je ne me rappelle plus bien lorsque je l'ai vu dérouler ses foulées pour la première fois, passer le virage de... tenir tête aux Américains, arriver deuxième, être sur le podium. Je ne me rappelle plus bien l'émotion de voir ce drapeau africain inconnu, bleu, vert et rouge, avec ce soleil incandescent, comme celui brûlant au-dessus du désert du Namib. Escorté par les drapeaux américains, comme mis sous tutelle par les pays du Nord. Le drapeau vole au vent, fierté d'une nation dont je n'ai jamais auparavant entendu le nom, la Namibie. Est-ce à ce moment que mon voyage a commencé? Lorsque Frankie, sur la ligne de départ, réagissant à l'appel de son nom, lève la main et salue la foule d'un air humble, digne, sans cette assurance toute américaine de celui qui sait qu'il va pouvoir ralentir avant la ligne d'arrivée, tellement il domine la discipline. Il ne fait pas le show, non. Il est là pour se battre. Il est là pour allonger ses jambes, happer la piste, grignoter petit à petit l'espace qui le distancie de l'Américain Carl Lewis, du Barbadien Atto Boldon ou du Canadien Donovan Bailey. C'est gagner centimètre après centimètre son droit à monter sur le podium, même en deuxième position. C'est courir le plus vite possible, manger l'asphalte, gérer son souffle, entendre son cœur battre, être porté par la foule. C'est rassembler son énergie du plus lointain de son être, comme si tu ne vivais que pour ce moment. Est-ce l'air chaud de Windhoek, la poussière du township où tu es né qui t'ont poussé jusqu'à la ligne finale? Est-ce là que mon voyage a commencé? It's the last one. Faites de sorte que toute l'Afrique combatte les Allemands. Mourons plutôt ensemble au lieu de mourir de mauvais traitements, de prison ou encore d'autres manières. Samuel Maharero. Mais les hereros sont petit à petit encerclés et obligés de fuir en direction du désert du Kalahari. Von Trotha, nouveau gouverneur, qui deviendra sous le Troisième Reich fureur d'honneur des jeunesses hitlériennes, fait empoisonner tous les points d'eau. La seule issue pour le peuple herrero est de marcher, d'oublier la faim, la soif, et d'oublier que les dunes rouges du désert formeront une enclave pour leur tombeau à ciel ouvert. Ceux qui ne meurent pas de soif meurent empoisonnés. En octobre 1903, apprenant la sanglante défaite de Maharero, Hendrik Witboy s'empare des armes et accompagné de 1500 hommes, il tue 40 colons, épargnant lui aussi les femmes et les enfants. Les Allemands n'en feront pas de même avec sa propre famille. Les Namas connaissent leur terre, ils se déplacent vite, de nuit, à la faveur du vent. Comme portés par une inspiration divine, Witboi mène ses hommes comme des soldats de l'ombre. Ils agissent discrètement, attaquant les Allemands en même temps, en différents endroits du territoire. Peu de morts à chaque fois. Mais ils agissent comme des moustiques, à tourner autour de l'oreille allemande chaque nuit, insaisissable perturbateur. Ils harcèlent leurs geôliers par des milliers de petites piqûres, avec le bourdonnement annonciateur d'une nuit sans rêve, sans trêve, d'une nuit sans paix. La guérilla durait 5 ans. 5 années de nuit sans rêve, de nuit sans lune, pour ces Allemands perdus à l'autre bout du monde sur une terre qui ne leur appartient pas. 5 années pour montrer la dignité d'un peuple. La force de celui qui est prêt à tout pour la liberté. 5 ans de soubresaut pour éviter le génocide à venir.
Merci, Penda. Thank you very much. And we move over to Remy, who is going to read from his novel, The Internal Audience of One, which I tried to translate once the title into German, but I terribly failed. But the floor is yours. I'm looking forward to your text.
Thank you. Thank you, Julia. And thank you, Penda and Sylvia, for your great readings. It's intimidating to go after all of you, but I'll follow in Penda's footsteps and say that mine is also a prologue, which comes from the Eternal Audience of One. So yeah, here goes. Prologue, a long forgotten essay. The Last Ticket Out of Town by Seraphine Turihamwe. Windhoek has 3 temperatures, hot, mosquito, and fucking cold. The city is allowed 2 or 3 days of mild spring weather in early September before the unrelenting heat crowds them out until May. The summers are long and sweaty, so much so that job offers can be sweetened by throwing in the promise of air conditioning and an overseeing committee to adjudicate on room temperature disputes because white people do not know how to share. Summer nights are stifling. Cooling breezes heed their curfews and leave the night air still and warm from the day's lingering heat. The departing sun brings out the mosquitoes. They are organized. They are driven. If they could be employed, they would be the city's most reliable workforce. Alas, people do not have my vision. From sunset to sunrise, they make enjoying a quiet evening drink on a balcony a buzzing and bloody affair. June, July, and August are bitter and cold. An ill wind clears out the gyms. Running noses are the only exercise anyone gets in the winter. The city is called a city because the country needs one, but really, city is a big word for such a small place. But it would probably be offensive to have a capital town or a capital village, so someone called it a city. The title stuck. Life is not hard in Windhoek, but it is not easy either. The poor are either falling behind or falling pregnant. The rich refuse to send the elevator back down when they reach the top. And since cities require a sturdy foundation of tolerated inequalities, Windhoek is like many other big places in the world. It is a haven for more, but a place of less. If you are not politically connected or come from old white money, then the best thing to be is a tourist. The city and the country fawn over tourists. The country's economy does too. That is when it's not digging itself poor. That is Windhoek. The best thing to do in the city is arrive and leave. The mistake you want to avoid making is trying to make the most of it. My parents did that. I have not forgiven them for their sense of optimism. You will notice it in many people. There's a strange national pride I cannot explain. A patriotic denial of the reality. Beware of that optimism. It'll creep up on you. It'll make you notice how in the early morning, the streets are hushed and the city's pulse is slowed down to a slow, rhythmic, nearly non-existent thump, thump. The only people to be seen on the streets are drowsy night shift security guards, the garbage collectors hanging from the back of dumpster trucks as they do their rounds, and a few stray cats. That is when it's at its best. Windhoek has not yet prostituted itself to neon and skyscrapers, so our horizon is always a short hill climb away, and nature still squats on its outer extremities. The views are spectacular. The same optimism might lead an early riser to be up before the sun to see how the approaching light gently shakes the city awake. Alarm bells ring as children and parents prepare for school. The blue-collar workers make their way to a bus or truck stop and wait to be carried towards places of cheap labor. And the white collars may take their time getting to desks and offices. As the day brightens, the cracked tarmac, which lines the city's main arteries, sighs and stretches, preparing for the new day when the increasing traffic will make a viscous mess of commuters and taxis. When it is going at full tilt, Windhoek does slow at a slow hum. It pays respects to the Gregorian calendar and then some. Mondays and Tuesdays are busy. Wednesdays and Thursdays are reserved for concluding auxiliary matters. On Fridays, everything shuts down with a firm understanding that the weekend is in session and nothing and nobody should upset the established order of things. The city has strict boredom and business hours, and it keeps them. The autumn days after the high summer are the best. The sky is afire with an intense passion. It burns with bright orange and red hues which tug at unprepared heartstrings before blushing into cooler pinks that tickle the clouds. The day's fervor cools down into violent violets as evening approaches. Windhoek has good days and it has bad days, but ideally, you should not be here long enough to know that. If you have made the mistake of tarrying too long in the city and forgotten to purchase the last ticket out of town, you might have to do something more challenging. Actually live here.
Thank you so much, Remy, and thank you so much to Penda and Sylvia. Diverse texts, rich texts, and penetrating to the soul indeed. And the question which I would like to ask you all, the three of you, is why do you think that the excerpt that you read to us is of particular significance to us as an audience? Why did you really choose those texts? Maybe you can start with Penda. Why did you specifically choose that excerpt which you read to us?
Thank you for this question. And I would like to thank you for the readings. It was very beautiful to hear. Maybe I think I chose these three different extracts to stick to the idea of diversity of the themes and of the writing. I choose to read an extract of the prologue because it's about the dunes in Namibia and about the history. The second one is more about about my life when I was a teenager and when I discovered Frankie Fredericks. And the last one is more about the history of Namibia and about the beginning of the genocide. And I thought it was three different way to enter in my writing, maybe.
Thank you very much. And Sylvia, your text from your short story, why necessary that part?
Well, I actually sat down yesterday and went through stories and couldn't decide which one to take. And I'm glad I chose this one because I'm very happy how beautifully it actually tied in with what Remy was reading, because we were both talking about the complicated relationship one can have with Windhoek. And but that's not why I chose this this text. I chose it to show how we as Namibians, or how I as a Namibian, grapple with identity, and identity that is linked to language, that is linked to the places we live in Namibia, the rural and the urban, and obviously our racial and tribal problems or difficulties, and how these then overlap to create a sometimes painful patchwork of a life. And I also chose this excerpt because here I play with one of the tropes that is often used in African literature when we write about Africa, and that is the one of the speaking animal and the African landscape. So that is, yeah, those are some of the reasons why I chose this, because this, yeah. Similarly to the excerpt that Remy chose, but in a slightly different way, in a more speculative fiction kind of way, it shows the complicated relationship we have as individuals to the diversity that defines us as Namibians, and also as Namibian and African writers.
The centrality of Windhoek as a city, and over to you, Remy, because the way you projected the city, it makes me to actually close my eyes and imagine what you were explaining. But why really that specific portrayal?
I think for me, for this panel, and for this festival of narrating Africa, I specifically chose this prologue and this section because it is what I think is a non-traditional rendering of Windhoek in literature. I do not romanticize it. I don't think I necessarily subscribe to that visitor or tourist narrative of visiting places and only talking about the nice things, because the nice things are here and they're evident and they're clear to us as Windhoek citizens or people who live in the city, but the bad things are sometimes always hushed or kept away. I also chose it because in a weird kind of way, I think it is funny, and Windhoek is an absurd place to be living in, and you're always waiting for, you know, you're always waiting for the joke for the punchline to happen to things, because sometimes things happen to you in Windhoek and you feel like you're in a comedy or you're in a candid camera thing and you're looking around for things to tell you that, don't worry, we're recording, this is not real life, and you're always waiting for that punchline to come through, and sometimes it doesn't, and then you realize, oh, this is real, this is Windhoek, this is how things are happening, this is real life. And for me, it was important to highlight that because I think this is a funny place to be living in. And I think, like with all humor, if you pick behind the things that make the jokes, the construction that make the stories, you arrive at some very disturbing truths about life over here. And those are the things that I wanted to confront, not only in my writing, but with this prologue, and also within this platform about narrating Africa, because it's happening online, and in which, for example, a large majority of Windhoekers will not be able to participate, either because of connectivity issues or the platform in which this thing happens. I think it is important for me as a Windhoeker to state my claim or where it is that I'm speaking from. And again, lastly, as the child of immigrants, as having been nationalized and now being a Windhoeker myself, it's also an authoritative way of saying that, you know, I now claim this place as home. And once you claim something as home, you're basically allowed to say whatever it is that you want to say about it, because home is where you have the hard conversations. I think every person who's grown up in Africa or has African parents knows that there are certain things you never ever say outside of the home environment. You know, you keep that for home. And so for me, in being naturalized and then claiming Namibia as home and embedding myself into the social fabric, it's sort of like a coming across and saying, so since now this is home for everybody, of which I'm also included, then we need to have these conversations. And in for this festival specifically, narrating Africa, it's again saying that I've claimed this place as home. And so whatever it is that we're talking about in narrating Africa, where I'm speaking about it as someone who belongs here, not as like as a passerby, because those conversations are quite different, for at least for us, as I've experienced them as a Windhoeker, as a Namibian, and as an African. And so for me, that's really the main motivation. Like, I'm writing about home, and if we're going to talk about home, these are the things I want to talk about.
Thank you, Remy. I will just stay with you with a few questions. You do know that I love your prologue. When I read it the first time, I felt like, yes, he's writing out of my heart and my experience. However, your novel, which I assume is bits and pieces are autobiographical, or maybe you have experienced something similar, but it is more like a story of a young man growing up in not only in Windhoek, but also in a migrant family in Windhoek, but then also going to a prestigious school where there is also a specific society. And then later on going over to Cape Town to study there again at a prestigious university where I sometimes get the feeling the protagonist is a bit lost. He has his circle of friends and he's definitely the center of the circle of the friends. But it feels like he's not really blending in there. Can you maybe elaborate a little bit on that? What your idea was to portray your protagonist in the setup of a diverse maybe society
here,
this is the topic of our conversation tonight.
Well, thank you for having read my prologue and liked it, Julia. That's one person. So I consider it a huge achievement. in the novel, the young man who's at the heart of the story, Seraphin, really struggles with living in Windhoek for many reasons. One, for him as a young person, and in the time in which the novel takes place, this young man's been raised on things like MTV. He's grown up watching the world happen outside. And so it seems to him that the best of the world, you know, all the best concert, all the big soccer matches, all the festivals, everything, anything that is cool happens outside of Windhoek. It's not an un-alien feeling, because a lot of people who are growing up in Windhoek are still growing up in that tradition. The best concerts happen abroad. If someone says, if a big artist comes out and says they are planning a world tour and they're coming to Africa, that means they're going to Cape Town or Joburg, not Windhoek. So it always seems like the best things always happen outside, and that contributes to the young man's feeling of not really being at home. It's also coupled with the fact that he's not originally from Namibia, and this place is extremely hostile to people who are not from here or who are identified as not being from here. And that really applies to a very small and a very, like, you know, unspoken demographic of Namibia. That just applies to Black Africans. So if you're from Zimbabwe, Zambia, Botswana, Lesotho, Angola, it's made to you very clear from upfront that you're not from here. And so the ways in which you're allowed to integrate and fit in are very limited to you. This does not apply in any way to European foreigners or travelers or tourists. They're made to feel welcome. And so, you know, from personal experience, when people say, oh, Namibians are very friendly, I'm like, where and when and to whom? And these are things that are sort of like addressed in the book. But his feeling of loss really comes from not having been able to find that sense of home anywhere he's lived. He's been forced to live Rwanda. He's lived in Nairobi for a little bit. And now he's living in Namibia, which goes out of its way to make him feel that he doesn't belong. And so for a lot of people in that age group, people looked for non-nationality based modes of home, which is why people in schools were so very loyal to like their house colors and their tribe and you know, their specific team or group of friends. And it's the same thing when they went abroad to university, these very big diverse campuses with people from all over the world studying together in any given place. That, for example, was a sense of pseudo belonging. And so when you made friends from all over the world, you sort of like felt like, I don't fit in everywhere. And that kind of like contributed to the feelings of detachment, of not really having a direction in life, because a lot of people, perhaps from my age group, but also I'm seeing it happen now, is they don't feel like, you know, well, where do we belong? What is home? What is Windhoek to us? How do we fit in? How do we, especially if you're immigrant, that's something that can never, that's very hard for people to understand, that, you know, this place, this country, this society goes out of your way to make sure that you do not feel integrated. And that it makes you feel like, you know, you're here as a privilege, like you should be lucky to be here. Even though deep down, you know, you're like, really, come on, man. Like, Beyonce doesn't even know this place exists. But that kind of like nationalistic arrogance that comes with being a born and bred Namibian is something that contributes to a whole lot of other people not feeling integrated. And I think those are the things that really fuel this young man's sense of directionless. And so when you're not made to feel to fit in anywhere, the first place you want to fit in is any place that is welcoming, which is why, for example, a lot of immigrant literature comes from what people call the big places of the world, like New York, like London, like Berlin, bigger places where there are way more melting pots, where you are allowed to have a voice as a non, as an outsider, whereas here, not so much. And I think that sense of not fitting in contributes to him continuously not fitting in anywhere except within his group of friends, because within those group of friends, passports don't matter. All of them are foreign in some way. They are all either at odds with their city, with their neighborhoods, with their culture, with their countries, with their specific side of the hemisphere. And that's just what I really wanted to, I use that as a springboard for exploring a lot of the themes and the plot, how the story envelops. But for me specifically, the not fitting in within Windhoek, within Namibia, and then having the opportunity to go abroad, that is something I've seen mirrored in a lot of people's experiences here.
I don't want to interrupt you, but
yeah, yeah,
exactly
go ahead.
What I had seen when you launched the book, and the young people actually standing up and saying, for the first time, I feel this is a novel talking to me or talking about me. And and I thought, yes, because we also need other, we need new and we need fresh literature. And it looked like that a lot of people, maybe with migrant background or not, felt like they could relate to what you were presenting in that novel. And I think that's very important that we need that as well. And I think one last comment, maybe also for the audience, the protagonist actually goes back to Windhoek. So it looks like he is finding his home again, or at least he's open to start again all over after his tour. But I would like to also tend to Penda. Penda, I read your monodrama. I actually don't even know if I pronounce it properly. And I had to look it up as a literature professor. I had to look it up again. What is the definition? And because when I read it, it didn't really click to me as a play. It rather read to me as a poem or even an unconventional story with a stream of consciousness, because you're experiencing Namibia, the dunes, as you said, but then you're going back into some historic events, quotes from Africans or Namibians, but on the other hand of the German colonizers. Then you go into your own childhood, how you experienced racism and not belonging. And I have actually a lot of questions to keep it short, because I want you to talk. Is firstly, is your monodrama even a mixture of different genres? As I said, it can read maybe even as a poem or as a story. And secondly, I also found that the monodrama is often used in therapy. And I'm just asking quite frankly, as you reveal your past as well, was it for you a kind of therapy, either to travel through Namibia and to relate, or to write that piece?
I think about the therapy. I think I went to Namibia after I was depressed, and I decided to go to Namibia and to visit the country. And I think now I'm talking in this play or in this monodrama or in this poem, I'm talking about Namibia and about my trip, but it's not, I don't know the country. I don't have a day-to-day experience of the city or of the country. I met the country as a tourist. And I think what was very important is that I think it helped me in a way to understand who I was in a political sense, especially maybe on gender or racial issue. And when I went to Namibia, I didn't think, I didn't imagine to write about my trip over there. It came later because this text is, a writing commission on the theme of courage. And at the beginning, I didn't know what I was going to talk about. And after that, I was thinking about this sentence I heard a lot in Namibia because I was alone when I did my trip. You are a brave woman. And I heard it several times because I was alone and I was a Black woman alone during 1 month and a half. So I think people were very surprised. And I wanted in this play to speak about courage, not mine, because I don't feel so courageous, but I wanted to talk about the courage of people who had fought for their freedom and about whom very little had been heard in Europe and especially in France. And for me, it was important to link between my own story as a Black woman in France about what happened in Namibia and during the Second World War in Europe, especially the Shoah, and to link the scientific experiments on humans, Eugene Fischer in Namibia, Joseph Mengele in Europe, and to speak about the concentration camps, Shark Island, and Auschwitz or Birkenau in Germany. It was for me important to knit all these stories, mine. The story of this travel and the story of the country, because the link was maybe the Black body and the way the Black body could have been denied in Namibia at the beginning of the century or now. Last year, George Floyd died because he was a Black man. So for me, it was important to speak about that. And the way I found to speak about it was to go back to this travel, who was very important for me and for my political, I don't know how to say, my political recognition of myself, something like that, yeah. I speak about a lot of things, and I have like a metaphor of coudre, to think. I don't know. What is the word for coudre?
I'm sorry, my French is non-existing.
It's not neat. It's like with
crochets.
Sewing. Sewing. Wait.
Thank you. Oh. Yeah, perfect. So I want a few different histories and different geographies.
Yeah, and I do like your metaphor of the knitting, but it's not really with a pattern, because you as a reader, you always fall into these dips again, because reading it feels like it lulls you a bit in, and then all of a sudden there's a different sentence structure or just words here and you wake up again. So it's not an easy read, but I loved listening to it, and this is why I think it sounds like a poem to me, and beautiful, but at the same time it yeah, it has that pain all over, and I don't know if I can enjoy the dunes again and not thinking of the tears and the pain there. So I found it very intense reading and re-experiencing the suffering, even though it's not always so overt or openly described. So thank you very much, Penda, for that. And I don't want to neglect Sylvia. I also have a question. And for everyone else, if you have questions, please drop them in the chat or keep them for afterwards. We will, in about 15 minutes, we will open the floor for questions from everyone. And obviously also Penda and Remy and Sylvia, you can ask questions. Huh? You're not here just to answer everything. So Sylvia, what I like about your stories is that I sometimes don't like them. They disturb me and they shake me. And I have a couple of favorites which are not so disturbing, but today you chose one of the stories that disturbs me. But I looked at it and enjoyed it even more because I looked at it today from the diversity perspective. And diversity means also to make space for others. And I look into just Jackal Waldemar, and I think he is definitely an outsider, and he's definitely different. He's not the normality. He's speaking, he's singing in a bar, and he's in love with his mother. So that's my disturbance, you see that. Most of your stories actually have that feature of disturbing, and I think using the diversity as a disturbing feature. Am I right with that? Would you even characterize your stories like that too?
No, I would say if you say they disturbed you, then I've reached one of my goals and one of my purposes as a writer, which I do see as to disturb with the images and the language I use. And I guess that is because I am disturbed as well as a writer and as a Namibian, as an African, writer who tries to put together all these things that make up my own identity and that of my fellow human beings, because I don't think this is a uniquely African problem. It's actually a very universal one, and our world as a whole is becoming more and more diverse. We're actually becoming more and more aware of this diversity. And to me, Namibia is it's the perfect example of the condition postmoderne. It's actually Africa, and for me in particular, Namibia is a postmodern universe. We have such a multitude of perspectives from which we see Africa and the world, and such a multitude of perspectives from which we tell our stories. And I think that is why what you might also find disturbing, because in most of my stories, even in the ones that you might not find so disturbing, there's a certain brokenness to the characters, but also to the the perspectives they take. I like changing perspectives. I like breaking them, because that does mirror my experience. It's a bit like what Leonard Cohen said, and I know this is overquoted, but it's just true. There's a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in, and that applies to us here too.
And I'm actually thinking now, all three of you disturb me with your writings, huh? But I think, yes, I guess that's what we need in order to wake up, in order to think, and in order to reflect and to be critical and not just to consume the light literature. So that would be maybe a definition even for lighter literature. So thank you for the disturbances.
Would you have preferred to read the vampire story?
Oh, yeah, no, I read them all, but as I said, yeah, disturbing me, but also disturbing the students I have read them with, and really polarizes basically the students. Some love it, and I can even identify or see the criticism, and others feel totally disturbed. So I have encountered that. Yes, we have still some time left. Nelson, do you have maybe a question to the authors as well before we also attend to questions from the audience?
Yes, please. Remy, I will be your obedient servant and answer a not so complicated question. But listening to what you have read, you made us to reflect on the complexities of diversity. And these are various, and racial, cultural, transnational, belonging, sexual, you name them. Which one do you think is quite critical and features the most in your novel, and why? Maybe just try to make it brief so that I can answer, ask also to other questions to the other presenter or authors. Can you unmute yourself, Remy?
Yes. Yeah, thank you so much for simplifying, giving me the easy question. I love those easy questions. And can we just agree that once someone quotes Leonard Cohen, the panel is over. That's like, it's finished. Like, he's so brilliant. There's no way you can like top someone quoting Leonard Cohen. So now that the panel is officially over, we can have an informal discussion. to answer your question, Prof. Mlamlo, I think the one that features most in mine would be the one that seemed most pressing to me when I was growing up and when my peers were growing up, and the one that's always informed the reading interest that I really gravitate towards. And that for me has always been nationality, how people's sense of identity is tied to where they were born. And mine has always been forced to shift because I'm no longer in the country of my birth. I haven't been back since 1994. And that has always, it's always been weird to spend more time in Rwanda and call myself Rwandan, even though I haven't been back. And then when I'm freshly nationalized, to say that I am Namibian, but then I have this other thing. And so for me, it's always been, that's been the biggest thing, how our sense of identity is tied to where we're from. And you know, what Sylvia says about disturbing literature is I think it's very good that it disturbs. I think literature should disturb, should shake us from our status quo and whatever it is that we're thinking. And so, and then what she says about the world becoming more diverse, I think it's always been diverse. You know, I think we've always had this nationality, these identities. It's just what's more common is ways in which they become, they come into friction, or they, where they encounter each other. And then what is often displayed is just our inability to encounter the other and treat them as equals in a way. And that for me has always been, was the thing that I was interested most in the novel. All these people who meet each other, their nationalities fall away when they find they have simple things in common, like they're all like punk rock, or they're all like partying, or they're all like being irresponsible together. And you know, when you have those commonalities between each other, you sort of like wonder how then, you know, if me and Julia have the same interests because we love literature, and me and Penda have the same interests because we travel through Namibian sand dunes, and even though we were able to appreciate this beauty, we could still grasp the deep traumatic history behind these vast open landscapes. What really is the point of, you know, being tied to these identities, at least nationalistic identities, because we all have these things that seem to transcend home affairs and visas and whatnot. That for me was the most interesting thing. And as usually, as Julia said, at the launch was interesting because non-Namibians who live here and Namibians who live here seem to find some sort of common ground in the writing. And that for me was interesting. And that again, when you're, if this is home, then this is where we can sort of like start having those hard conversations about what keeps us different and apart, and what ways we can come and bring things together. So thank you so much for that easy question that I could answer. And please give all the hard questions to Penda and Sylvia. Like, it's always nice being surrounded by smart women, because then I can be the dumb guy.
Thank you so much, Remy, for also speaking to my rich heritage, which is displayed behind me. Quickly, yes. So when
I'd like to add something in between. Remy, you'd be really surprised, and I don't understand this either, but there are a surprising lot of people that don't like punk rock.
Thank you, Sylvia. Now, so quickly, of course, your stories, I happen to teach them at third year level, and they can make the students uncomfortable, yet they actually fall in love with the short stories. And one of the dimensions which I have found is the eco-critical dimension. The way you enthuse present to us the link between the animal world and the human world, especially your fascination with the jackal. One of your stories actually says, at the Tropic of the Jackal. Why this fascination with old wild animals and especially the jackal?
Well, the jackal
is a symbol of something.
Okay. The jackal is, on the one hand, it's kind of like a totem animal to me. I feel, I do feel akin to the jackal, that he's clever, but he's not a predator really. He's a scavenger. He's beautiful, but not, or she, they are binary too. They are beautiful, but not in the typical big five kind of way, which is what we usually cling to when we think about Africa. So in that sense, it's a kinship, like I said, like a kind of a totem animal. And on the other hand, you're completely right. It is a metaphor for all the things and the characteristics that I just mentioned about that totem animal. And it's a metaphor of for the person or the being that belongs and that doesn't belong at the same time. So it's a metaphor for Remy and for me, and probably for Penda as well, and for Julia, and for you too, Mr. Lamowitz. Like I said, you're not the big five, but you are an African animal, and that's, so it's a, for that it's a metaphor. And the story you referred to, the tropic, no, the tropic at the Tropic of Jackal. It ends with that signboard in that dystopian world in the future, where the German colonizers have actually come back to make Namibia a protectorate after an atomic catastrophe. And the story ends with, we must stay outside, like similarly to like dogs are not allowed everywhere. And that is also, it's a metaphor, and in a way it's a metaphor also for my own community, which is supposed to be the German speaking community in Namibia, which I've not always felt perfectly aligned with, to say the least. But on the other hand, it's not when real Germans, we call them German Germans, when they come to Namibia and they find these relics or the leftovers of the colonizers who came here, people like me, and we are treated like we are sometimes treated a bit like backwards. No? It almost feels like Germans are ashamed, no? To find these species that look like them, that talk a bit like them, but they are not like us. No? We prefer them to stay outside and to stay where they are. And that is in Namibia. Never mind that we do want to stay. So that is maybe that explains the jackal a bit more.
Thank you very much. I think you have done well, especially when you say that dogs are not allowed, and the dystopic dimensions of your short stories are quite unnerving, really, and quite enlightening as well. And then finally to Penda, in your monodrama, you see pain, suffering, and trauma. And in the excerpt which you read to us, you used the word remember several times. I don't know what you will say that in French. You said remember, remember, that word you actually used it many times. And at the end of that excerpt, you contrasted it with the word of forgetting. And I'm asking myself, are we not supposed to forget the trauma, the history, the genocide, and all that, so that we can heal? What is your take on that? Are we supposed to remember, or are we supposed to forget so that we can heal?
Thank you for this question. I think I'm not speaking about I have in mind another traumatic experiences, or not only in Namibia, but I think if we want to go on, we have to speak about things who are difficult, and we have to deal with, and then after it's easier for us to think about other things. But if we do as if it never existed, I think this trauma will be perpetuated. And if you forget it, maybe it will come back with your children and your grandchildren. So I think it's necessary to speak about it and to try to understand what happened. And after that, everything is more serene, and it's easier to live your life and to forget it in a way.
We were told by 9:15 we should attend to the questions from the audience. That gives me another 3 minutes, and I have one question for all three of you. As in the exhibition tour earlier this evening, one author was quoted saying she needed to learn who she's writing for. Are you writing for an European audience, or are you writing for your African or your Namibian audience? And I just wanted to ask all three of you, you are all narrating Africa, all differently, some narrating Namibia, but all narrating Africa. Who are you writing to? Who are you writing for? Anyone can shoot.
I'm gonna answer with Remy's book title. I'm writing for an eternal audience of one, which is also the but the audience of everybody. I feel ideally we should not be writing for a specific. I don't have a specific audience in mind when I write, because I write what comes out of me. And what I would like to share. And ideally, I'm one of those writers that would actually like to share that with the whole world, and not just my family and my co-nationals. Yeah, so that would be my answer. Your stories also always end up speaking to more to certain audiences than to others. But I think we are in dire need of getting away from the idea, and I think that became very clear in the exhibition as well, that we as African writers need to decide which audience we are writing for. This is not asked of writers from any other continent.
That's actually true. No.
I came to literature by the good graces of Roald Dahl and this wonderful girl called Matilda, who I wanted to be smarter than because I desperately needed friends and I didn't have any. And Roald Dahl was Norwegian living, and then he moved to London, I mean Britain. And then I discovered his books in Namibia. So because those are the first books I discovered, and I've always felt like I don't have to write for a specific audience. Whoever finds your books and enjoys your story is probably who you are writing for. And so I've never felt this limitation of saying I'm writing for immigrants living in Namibia or, you know, Nigerians living in London or wherever. It's if you enjoy reading and you enjoy stories, like the essence of story, like a good story that keeps you riveting, something with the Tropic of the Jackal, I mean, that title, whether you're in Australia or the moon or the next solar system, you will find resonance in a story that is well told. And so for me, I think stories that are well told don't really have one audience. They just have readers wherever they can be found. And I agree with Sylvia when she says that, you know, she's never limited herself in saying that I'm writing for Namibians. Well, you know, with the way the literary scene is in Namibia, if you say you're writing for Namibians, you're maybe writing for a couple of hundred of people. That's just not enough. You want your work to go wherever it's appreciated. And so I really do agree with her that, you know, African writers should not be constrained with this idea that we must write for Africans. No, we write the stories that we want to tell. We tell them as the best way that we can. And hopefully they will find resonance not only here, but also elsewhere. And I think the idea of writing for for particular audiences is always peddled to people from less established literary traditions. So Black Brazilian writers will be asked, were you writing for Black Brazilians? Like, no, they were writing for whoever read it. And if I happen to be a Namibian doing so, then that's it. And so I really do hope that we reach a stage where even though we are narrating Africa, we're narrating stories from Africa for whoever is interested in stories from here or stories in general. Because, you know, Lord forbid, Matilda has got nothing Namibian about her, but for some reason, this girl, this character, this book, this man is who brought me to literature. So for me, wherever you are, if a story well told really doesn't have an audience, wherever your work can be read is always a good place. Yeah.
Thank you. And Penda?
I agree, and I hope that maybe the story about a Black woman in France can be as universal as another one. And when you speak, I think about with your heart, you and you work about your language and everything, and you speak about your intimacy, I think you can touch everybody.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Just to interrupt, Julia. Yes, sure. Julia, just to interrupt. Can we just agree that if some place was called the Tropic of the Jackal, we'd all go and visit this place? Like, that just sounds like a place we must go to, the Tropic of the Jackal. Can you imagine, like, people sitting around, have you been to the Tropic of the Jackal? Yes, I've been to the Tropic of the Jackal.
I'll think about it next time I'm at the Tropic of the Capricorn. I'll think of that and I send you a picture.
They spray some graffiti onto the signboard there.
No graffiti there. Okay, I think we are getting into insider jokes now for our international and very German audience now, but let me attend to some of the questions in the chat, and Madeleine, maybe you can also open up for people if they want to ask questions, that they can also phrase or ask the questions here in our Zoom meeting. What I have here, I'll skip a few. Let me see. More of Penda Diouf's work translated by Amelia Parentour can be found here. And there's a website at Princeton University in America. So this is where one can Google or just click on the link that is given in the chat. Then Marianne Zappen-Thompson says, at Remy, I like the fact that you call yourself a windhooker, and that makes your view so special. Thank you for that. Yes, Remy thanks us for his easy questions. I have that, thank you. Then I have from Julia Rensing at Remy. First, I'd like to say that I really loved your book and I hope it's okay if I ask a question that goes beyond your prologue. You say as a Windhoeker, you feel free to speak openly and honestly about the place. And I wonder whether in comparison, there were other aspects or perspectives that you felt unable to speak more deeply about as an author. I'm thinking specifically about the role of Seraphine's mother. When I finished the book, I sat down and I thought more about her and felt I would love to read a second book, maybe a continuation, smiley. Now, so I can learn more about her. She remained somehow in the shadow of those stories of the men in the book. For example, in comparison to the husband's past, where there's some uneasiness or something holding you back, maybe to speak about a mother's perspective?
The short answer, the long answer is that no, there are no uneasiness or trepidations about addressing particular perspectives and that kind of thing. For me, I think what ultimately brought the story out in its final form, and Sylvia and Penda can speak to this, is sometimes the story comes to you as it is, and then either as a writer, because of your strengths or weaknesses, you do not address particular perspectives or certain characters. You gravitate to the ones that drive the plot along. And then later on, as you look at the story, you think yourself as a writer, because even as a writer, you do have a perspective. You prefer one angle or one version to another. And ultimately, the version that we have with the book, the mom character, is one of the, she doesn't play a, no, she plays a big role, but her past is not examined as much as the others, I guess because it wasn't integral to the movement of the plot or the devolution of action or the where I felt as a writer the story was going. This ultimately, at the reading of it, a lot of people said, you know, whoa, everybody sort of like gets what they want and they sort of like arrive where they need to be. But the mom character is the only one who loses something, her way of life, her dreams, her ambitions and whatnot. And in some ways, I felt like, well, that is ironically a little bit true about parents, a lot of parents in migration, not only here, but everywhere else, because, you know, we still live in a very patriarchal world. Whenever migrant parents move abroad, fathers are often more likely to still get work, pursue their careers and achieve some sort of success, whereas moms, not so much. And so perhaps inadvertently that played out in the novel, but it wasn't intentional. I also do accept that, you know, I was a debut author. This is the first work. I was feeling and learning a lot of things as I went along. And the original draft or manuscript in retrospect was perhaps more voluminous, but a little more complete with regards to the mom character. So when you see a book, a lot of people have actually touched it. So it's not only just my work, but it's also a lot of editorial input that has gone in. You know, let's dumb down this, let's go this way, let's prune this way. So ultimately, what you're seeing is a first iteration of of the story that I wanted to tell and that I hope that I told well. And yeah, a mother's perspective is always an interesting thing to write. You know, I love reading books in which mothers are very strong characters, not just plot devices, but like where they're actual drivers of the story. I do enjoy, you know, those types of perspectives. Whether I, however, want to write those perspectives is another issue. And I think Penda said this when, you know, when she says she traveled through Namibia and she looked for ways to link these particular things together to form some sort of narrative. I think storytellers of any kind are always looking for an excuse to tell some sort of story. And in a way, the characters we have are an excuse for us to drive a story in a particular way. And so the mom's silence or absence in particular situations is also both deliberate and accidental. Yeah.
Thank you, Remy. I don't see any other question here, just some discussion on jackals and favorite animals. And Marianne Zappen-Thompson, that is so true, Sylvia. Thanks for that. I'm not exactly sure what it refers to, or if it refers to outsiders have the best view. Are there any other questions from the audience?
I have a question.
Or from the panel, yes.
I have a question for Sylvia and Penda. And I'd like to ask them, as writers who have, on the one hand, traveled through Namibia, and as a writer born and living in Namibia, what are the types of stories that you really do wish that would come out from the country that are not, or that you encounter that you hope would do? So Penda, more likely from Africa, or from France, where she lives, from her African community, and for Sylvia living in Namibia, what are the stories that you'd really like to see coming through that are not? Yeah, I'm just curious about that.
You mean stories coming from Namibia?
You look at like what other literary traditions in the world are putting out, and you're like, man, we wish we could have more Namibian erotica. Because I mean, I'm sure people are up to shenanigans here, aren't they? But we don't get Namibian erotica, you know, type for example.
Yeah, I'd actually like to see more what they call genre fiction coming out of Namibia. That is, I don't know, paranormal science fiction. I'm a science fiction fan. It's also what that's the kind of thing that I would like to come, to see more in Namibia, but also in Africa in general. But we have shining examples like Nnedi Okafor from Nigeria, yeah, for example. I believe that literature is only completely free when it can venture into those genres that are disconnected from a bit more disconnected from the political and social agenda that is sort of expected of us. Mm. Over to you, Kenda.
I think I would like to read stories that show I would like to read stories which don't show the African continent maybe as an exotic space with another perspectives, with no stereotypes or sad things like economics about I don't know pandemics about AIDS about poverty. I think I would like another way to see the continent. What about you?
I have no problem with pandemics, with poverty, with AIDS, with war, with any of these things. So long as they are reality on the continent, they must be written about. The only thing, like as you correctly said, is avoid stereotypical writings about them. You know, like I think one out of Africa, one Karen Blixen is enough for a generation. And to move beyond, you know, that out of Africa narrative of like, you know, yeah, that romantic sun in the distance. And, you know, I think the hard conversations we need to have about poverty or about, you know, violence and all of those things need to be had. I just, for me personally, I'm more along the lines of, can we hear about them from the people who are there? So I don't think I need another like UN report writing about Central African Republic, because I'm sure there are Central African Republicans who can write about their own country. And I think that'll be more enriching to hear their own perspectives. And as you know, as Yulia said about Sylvia's work, I think those things will be delightfully disturbing and very necessary.
I just want to precise my thought. It's not, I'm not against, but I think here in France, we have only one focus, and this only focus is we don't have diversity about the country. And that's a problem. Yeah. Of course, it exists. And of course, we have to speak about poverty and everything. But it's the only way to speak about Africa. And for me, it's a problem.
I totally hear you.
And I think one cannot actually end panel better than with the words of Penda, that we need that. And then we need to write about Africa diversely and to show the different facets, the different pictures of Africa. I think we could have gone even further. I loved the entire evening, the entire day, actually, since we started a tour of the exhibition. I want to thank again profoundly everyone in this panel, Remy Ngamishe, Penda Diouf, Sylvia Schlettwein, and of course, Nelson Mlambo, for making this possible. For having such an entertaining, enriching, and diverse evening and discussion. And again, I want to thank the Deutsches Literaturarchiv for making this possible, for the ministry in Baden-Württemberg on initiating the Namibia initiative, and to make this cooperation and this event, these events happening. And of course, also our University of Namibia, that we cooperate with partners in Germany to engage in discussion, to engage in reflections, and to engage about our past as well, but also to move on. So thank you very much again, everyone. And I know we all have to go home because you have curfew. So get home safely. And I hope we see each other again at another time. Thank you very much. Dankeschön.
Thanks, everyone. Merci. Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you, Julia Algar and Nelson Mlambo.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
I'd also like to thank my colleagues on the technical team this evening. That's been Stephanie Hundejäger, Alina Palesch, and Sandra Moore. It's been wonderful to have such a large audience here. Don't forget, the recording of the events this evening will go up on YouTube later in the coming week. And of course, next Wednesday, 12th May, Nuruddin Farah and Jennifer Nansubugwa Makumbi will be discussing their work in our next panel, Reclaiming the Past, Reshaping the Present. And we hope to see you all there. Have a wonderful weekend and see you next week. Wonderful. Right, I don't know if you guys wanted to stay in the